Hello, this is Kaiser Harris, and today we're going to be talking about the French Revolution. As you can see, we have the French flag in the background, the blue, white, and red, and also Les Marseillaise, the French national anthem, playing in the background. Although we're American, we're very patriotic to the French. Alright, so just to give you what's coming up, we've got John David doing the causes of the French Revolution. Then we will have yours truly doing major people. And then we will have Sam and Matthew working together on main events. And then Thomas Barnes, otherwise known as your boy T-Tom, on consequences.
All right, I'm John David, and I did political causes of the French Revolution. First of all, absolute monarch, King Louis XVI. First of all, claim to divine right was no longer as strong, because he had the absolute authority. And second of all, King Louis XVI was too harsh in response to public criticism. This means that he didn't care what any of the people say, he just did what he wanted to. Next is the economic causes, and that is luxury spending and war debt. The absolute rulers spent more than the country made, which put them into much debt. King Louis XVI's wife is a symbol for overspending and was extremely hated because she spent the money on luxury items that weren't needed. The French spent too much in wars, the American Revolution and the Seven Years' War. All right, next is the social causes, and there was a rigid social structure in France during the French Revolution. The French population was divided into three groups. First was the clergy. They were 1% of the population, and they were at the top. Second were the nobles. They made up 2% of the population, and they were next. And at the bottom were just ordinary people like merchants, businessmen, and they made up 97% of the population. All three of these groups were unhappy with absolutism and took action quickly.
All right,
next we have the intellectual causes. This was spread and popularity of Enlightenment ideas. First off, I'm sorry. Okay, next we have the intellectual causes, and this was the spread. This was the spread and popularity of Enlightenment ideas. First off, philosophers in France did not call for violence revolution because it was against reason. Instead, their ideas helped challenge the order of things, or the status quo, and created a revolutionary state of mind in France. Okay, next we have the physical causes. The large population played a big part in the French Revolution. First of all, France had 20 million people living within its borders at the beginning of the 18th century. Epidemic disease, food shortage, and mortality was common among the people of France. The last cause of the French Revolution was King Louis XVI himself. First of all, his father had been a weak ruler, and his whole life he had not known a strong king. Second, he preferred personal interests rather than court interests, and therefore he had the delegated authority over the public.
All right, as John David said, King Louis, he was the French king from 1774 to 1792, and he was deposed during the French Revolution and later executed during the Reign of Terror. King Louis inherited the debt problem by his grandfather. He had a lot of spending in the American Revolution, trying to help out, but the debt like overwhelmed France, and they couldn't support that. All right, Marie Antoinette was the wife of King Louis, and in the French commoners' eyes, she was the primary symbol of the French's extravagance and excess by the royalty. When she was executed in 1793, they made sure that she wore a plain dress to show that she was just like the commoners. All right, next we have Napoleon Bonaparte. He was a general in the French army and a leader of the 1799 coup that overthrew the Directory. Napoleon's accession marked the end of the French Revolution and the beginning of Napoleonic France in Europe. All right, next we have Jacques-Pierre Brissot, and obviously we're in front of a different background. We had to swap locations, but we're still going to move on. All right, so Jacques-Pierre Brissot, that name definitely does not belong to an American. First of all, he was a member of the Legislative Assembly and National Convention, and he held a moderate stance and believed the idea of a constitutional monarchy. Brissot's followers, initially simply known as Brissotins, eventually became more known as the Girondins. After unsuccessfully declaring war on Austria and Prussia, Brissot was removed from the National Convention and like many Girondin leaders, lost his life at the guillotine during the Reign of Terror in 1793-1794. Alright, next we have Charles de Calonne. And he was the Controller General of Finance, appointed by King Louis after Jacques Necker was forced out of office in 1781. Calonne proposed a daring plan to shift the tax burden from the wealthy nobles and businessmen to the common people. However, the nobility did not like this, and they refused to pay the taxes, and it kind of caused an uproar. All right, the next guy we have is Lazare Carnot. And he's a French soldier appointed by the Committee of Public Safety to help recognize the failing war effort against Austria and Prussia. Carnot did so very effectively and made enough of a name for himself to earn a seat as a member of the Directory. And although he was removed from this position during the overthrow in September of 1797, he went on to hold various posts in future governments. Now we have Marquis de Lafayette. And he was a liberal nobleman who led the French forces in assisting in the American Revolution. The common people of France revered Lafayette as an idealistic man who was dedicated to liberty and the principles of the Revolution. Although Lafayette organized the National Guard of armed citizens to protect the Revolution from attack by the king, he balked as the Revolution became more radical and did not want a part of it. All right, the next French person we have is Maximilien Robespierre, and he was a brilliant political tactician and leader of the radical Jacobins of the National Assembly. As a chairman of the Committee of Public Safety, Robespierre pursued a planned economy and vigorous mobilization for war. He grew increasingly paranoid about the counter-revolutionary opposition. However, during the Reign of Terror of 1793 to 1794, he attempted to silence all enemies of the revolution in an effort to save France from invasion. After moderates regained power, they had Robespierre executed by the guillotine. Now we have Emmanuel Joseph Saïs. And he was a liberal member of the clergy, a supporter of the Third Estate, and author of the fiery 1789 pamphlet, What is the Third Estate? Saïs was one of the primary leaders of the Third Estate's effort at political and economic reform in France. And the Third Estate is it's the group that's the common people, and that's what we will talk about that later.
Hello, my name is Sam Critchlow, and I will be starting the main events of the French Revolution, and then Matthew will finish it out. Now, the meeting of the Estates General was called by King Louis on May the 2nd of 1789. Now, this meeting was called by King Louis because of the money problems due to the support of the American Revolution, and also because of their ancien regime. Now, this ancien regime was a part of their political system where they could not collect taxes, which also posed a problem. Now, along with both of these, the recent hailstorms hurt their money problems because it destroyed crops and caused an inflation of prices. Now, the meeting of these three estates were the first estate, the clergy with 100 people, the second estate, the nobles with 200 people, and the third estate, everyone else with 600 people. All right, they had many problems with money before the meeting of the Estates General, but the problems at the meeting were a lot worse. Now, these three estates argued for so long that the third estate actually left the room and created this National Assembly. Now, King Louis grew really angry at this and actually locked them out of the room and forbade them to take part in the meeting. Now, after he forbid the National Assembly from coming back into the room, they actually met at an indoor tennis court where they created the Tennis Court Oath. Now, the Tennis Court Oath was created and said, "We will not disband the National Assembly until a French Constitution was made."
I'm Matthew. Sam already told you that. And I have another main event of the French Revolution was the flight to Varennes in June of 1791. What it was a failed attempt for King Louis and his wife Marie Antoinette to flee the city of Paris in fear of being killed. What they were trying to accomplish was to meet up with Austrian troops in Luxembourg but they were arrested in Varennes, and they were taken back to Paris and became prisoners of and were arrested and became prisoners of a city that they once ruled.
All right, another main event of the French Revolution was the fall of Bastille, which Bastille was a prison that held political prisoners, and people in France now know the fall of Bastille and have it as a holiday called Bastille Day. Now, Bastille Day is because of the foreign troops entered Paris, which scared and angered normal people, and then wished to arm themselves and attack the political system for placing these troops in Paris's streets. They did this by storming Bastille, a political prison which symbolized the king's power. Surprisingly, though, there were only 7 prisoners instead of the 100 they were expecting. King Louis responded by firing the Third Estate's beloved Jacques Necker, who was the only man who listened and supported the Third Estate's opinion. The next main event of the French Revolution was the March on Versailles. Because of wheat shortages, high wheat prices, and the rumor that Lady Antoinette secretly stored wheat, a group of women stormed Versailles and demanded the royals to move to Paris.
With the tensions in Europe beginning to rise, the king felt that war would be a good thing, since France was a feared country by European monarchies. In April of 1792, France declared war on Austria. France feared Austria would try and reinstate King Louis to the throne, and France wanted to keep what they were, a republic.
Hello, class. We're guest visitors. Learn well.
Another main event was the attack on the Tuileries Palace. Austria and its allies from Prussia began to move into French territory. With King Louis was viewed as a traitor for fleeing the country, and the legislative branch was divided. In April of 1792, the Tuileries Palace was raided, and king and queen fled the city under protection of the Legislative Assembly and were arrested in fear of further violence. Another main event was the declaration of the Republic and the trial of Louis. With the arrest of the king and queen, the Legislative Assembly was no more. With the new Republic, government was known as the National Convention. Louis XVI was charged with treason and was killed by guillotine on January 21st of 1793. Marie Antoinette was convicted of other charges and was killed the same day.
Alright, it's your boy T-Town here. Alright. The main results of the French Revolution were the thought processes of life, liberty, and brotherhood. This was the main motto of the revolution. These ideas spread after Napoleon's final defeat. Also, the idea of equality was introduced. For example, primogenitive laws were passed which led to French peasants having fewer babies to avoid splitting family lands. Primogenitive laws were laws that gave the oldest son the major right of inheritance. Nationalism was also an idea that was introduced. Nationalism was the idea that everyone should be united, such as having a common language, history, and culture. Brotherhood brought the citizens into a larger, closer population. Because of the revolution, a whole new constitution was written for the principles of the nobles, including equal taxation and tithing. Also, the Declaration of Men was proclaimed, which reinstated the idea of all men were created equal. This represented the idea that everyone had the right to liberty, property, and security. First part of the revolution, the National Assembly believed that the king was necessary for a functioning state. Two, the voters in the assembly were biased toward men property holders. The National Assembly was the voice of the people, although they were biased. They decided to change the voting requirements to all men, and when this happened, they impeached Louis and King Louis and sentenced him to death. Once his beheading, the public went berserk and decided pretty much that if you could kill the king, you could pretty much kill anyone. This process led to mass chaos. Fun fact of the day, the assembly changed the hours of the day to 10 and the minutes in an hour to 100 while changing all the months and their names. Once Napoleon took office, he became the Council of France and ended the revolution just as quick as it started.
All right, this wraps it up. Hope you learned about the French Revolution. Check me out on Twitter at KaiserH.
And the Mr. Bones right here, boy.
At Crystal Sam.
And others who are not here right now. All right. Hope you learned a lot. Bye.